Praise the Lord. Here, use his mic. It's okay. Use this mic, Gary. Got it. Do it. Do it. He's got it.
It's not coming on.
Oh. Hey. Hallelujah. That's new. Good to see everybody. Hallelujah. Hey. This is the day that the Lord has made. And I will rejoice in it.
Yes.
I have a completely different aspect on life. It is such a blessing just to be able to come and assemble with you all and be able to know that the reason we're here is simply to praise and worship our Lord. You know, you hear things all the time about God is good all the time. Well, I got to tell you, God is good all the time. God is our healer. God is our provider. God is our everything. He is the source and only source for every good and perfect gift that will ever come to us. And that ought to put in our hearts such a desire to come and worship and praise Him. So I just want to know, I appreciate all the prayers that have been sent to me, texts and different things for me and my wife. You all are a blessing to us. And we love you. So we're going to open in prayer. No? We're, yes? Maybe? Is it all right? Father, we just come before you. We thank you for the opportunity to rise up this morning and come to church and assemble ourselves with the saints. We thank you that we are your body, your church. We thank you that we are your children, Lord, and that you watch over us. You put a hedge around us. You and you alone are our defense. And we just thank you and praise you. We ask, Lord, that you anoint this service. Cause it to be a service in which we truly enter into worshiping and praising you, keeping our eyes focused on you and nobody else but you, Lord. We're going to have music and hopefully some shouting and everything, but most of all, God, we just want to focus on you and let you know how much we love you. So we thank you, Lord, that as the service continues, your presence will continue to increase, because I'm expecting people to be healed, touched, without anyone except God doing it right where you sit. And in Jesus' precious name, the church said, amen.
Stand with us. Let's worship the Lord this morning.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me. Same God is never late, is working all things out, is working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will seek for joy when my your name. glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand again, and not just a praise. To glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand again. Oh yes, I will sing for joy.
Somebody say hallelujah to that. Amen. The God of heaven is my defense. Hallelujah.
Bring light to the darkness.
put your breath in our lungs, Lord God. And with that breath, we worship you today, Lord God. Father God, you've healed so many people. We have walking testimonies in our sanctuary today, Lord God. Even though the virus rages, you're still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And you have the victory. Hallelujah. Let's sing that again one more time, Demetrius, the chorus. It's your breath, Lord Jesus, in our lungs. And we worship you today. Sing to him, church.
Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath.
Hallelujah, Lord. We lift our hearts, our voice. We lift our hands to you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you're our healer and our deliverer. We thank you that you're our soon coming King. Lord God, the signs of the time are right in front of us. And so, Lord God, we're preparing our hearts to meet you in the air. Hallelujah. We're preparing our hearts to be used as vessels in these last times, that all people might know and see Jesus Christ in us and through us. We say, here we are, Lord God. Use us for your glory, for your honor. Quicken us. Open our hearts, our ears to hear. Give us that diligent spirit of excellence, Lord God. For we have it in Christ Jesus. We have it in the Holy Spirit. May we be diligent to apply it, to live in it, Father, for your glory and for your honor. And Father, because we have your breath in our lungs, healing flows through our body. If you're here and you're under attack, be healed in the name of Jesus. Before you leave here today, I believe you're going to be feeling healthy and strong and whole. If you're listening on the Facebook or on YouTube, you're healed in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we praise you for it, Lord. Because we have your breath flowing through our lungs, every one of our needs are met. Because you gave us all things unto life and godliness, Lord. It's already been given, already delivered into our hands. And so we thank you and we praise you. Father, let your quickening spirit, the Holy Spirit, right now open our ears to everything that we have sung and has been said and is about to be said. That, Lord God, we will be changed, transformed, renewed, and strengthened by the word of your power, by your inhabiting of our praise, by the quickening of your spirit. So we just give you the glory and the honor, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. And all the saints said, amen. Amen. Give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And Father, right now, as we are together in that spirit of praise, Father, we lift up Ida and Ophelia and their family, their brother Joe. He's home with you. He's in your arms right now, Lord. He was a man of God, a pastor. And Father, his destiny, all the days that he walked on this earth, was to stand in your presence. And Lord God, we rejoice. And we give you glory that right now he is in your presence. He is rejoicing. He is healed. He is whole. And we give you the glory. And we thank you for the family that right now are strengthened by that same Holy Spirit that raised him from the dead, Lord God, that took him and introduced him to you. We thank you that you're their comfort, their strength, their joy, Lord God. We ask you to continue to bless them in the upcoming days and weeks, Father. So we give you all the glory. We also thank you for the report of the Lord about Teresa. She's coming off the ventilator today. She is able to respond to questions. We thank you and we praise you, Lord God, for your mighty healing hands. We thank you for those that are here that have been under attack and have been made whole. Father, we have a lot to celebrate. We have a lot to shout praises for, because our God reigns over every sickness and disease, over every problem that would arise in our lives. Our God reigns. And so we give you a shout of praise. Hallelujah! Praise the name of the Lord. Give him some praise this morning. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Father, we thank you for this service. As Pastor Gary prayed, Father, we believe there's going to be healings and miracles. There's going to be revelation that is revealed in the hearts of your people. That, Lord God, every one of us in some way is going to be changed when we walk out these doors. And it's not going to be a temporary change. It's a permanent change. And the enemy shall not be able to rule over us any longer, Father, in any area, because you are the Lord God Almighty. And so we thank you, we praise you. We just want to tell you we love you this morning. In Jesus' precious name, and all the saints said, amen. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, be seated. We have some announcements for you.
Watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. But for the hurting in our city, would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now. Lord, start right here. Lord, start right now. I'm like the brother of the prodigal who turned his nose and puffed his chest. He didn't run off like his brother, but his soul was just as dead. What if the church on Sunday was still the church on Monday too? What if we came down from our towers and walked a mile in someone's shoes? 'Cause we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now. Lord, I'm starting right here. Lord, start right now. We're the people who are called by his name. If we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our way.
Praise the Lord. We have a lot going on, don't we? Do you notice, when you came in the door, you should have a bulletin in your hand. They were folded with gloves on. So you're the one that's going to touch it, so we will not transfer any germs. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Praise the Lord, because there's so much going on, you can't remember it. Ida said, we need a bulletin. Do you know it's been, next week will be 1 year since we had a bulletin. Is that insane? Well, I want to welcome all the She Rocks ladies. Can I hear an amen out there? It is about time. We've had 1 year since our last She Rocks meeting. We had Pastor Elizabeth with us. Can you believe that? So tomorrow we're going to gather together again. I sound like a country song, don't I? Together again. Anybody know that? There's a few out there, I'm sure. Okay, praise the Lord. We're going to be serving a light dinner to you ladies. You'll sit down. You will be served. We're going to have drawings, fellowship, And we're going to have five special guests bring the word. We're starting at 6:30, so you don't want to miss it. Make sure you have to be 18 and over. No children, please. Wear your mask and invite a friend. Hey, Karen, what are you doing with that mirror?
It's a reflection mirror. You can see your past.
Really? And you know your heart's upside down. I didn't need to get a rag on that thing. That looks pretty dirty. Okay, praise the Lord. What's in there? What's in it? Wow, I need to get back as a blonde. No. Hey, look in there. I see 1961 back there. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. This guy named Dennis, I was only 8 years old. He gave me my first kiss. Oh, my gosh. I was 8 years old. Can you believe that? Mia, don't be listening to that. Oh, my gosh. And well, hi, Letty. How are you? Oh, my gosh. And look, there I am in high school. I'm reflecting back. There I am in high school. And there's Bobby that I dated. He was super cute. You know, I thought I was going to marry Bobby. Huh? God had other plans. That's the truth. Oh, and that look.
That's a nice red Camaro.
A red Camaro? No, it's blue. Can't you see? It's kind of silver and blue.
Blue, red, whatever.
Yeah.
It's the mirror.
Oh, my gosh. Check that out. That's Tomas that was riding along with Ed when he cruised by East High to pick me up.
Did I know Tomas in high school?
Girl, you weren't even born yet.
That's right. I was born in 73.
Whatever. Oh, my gosh, yes, look at that. That's Ed. He is pretty cute. He is pretty cute there, isn't he?
He is cute as Thomas, I understand.
No. Oh, gosh, as we reflect back, so many things have happened. We met each other. I got saved. God had a different plan. He had a different plan. And I want to reflect the right plan from God. I'm excited about that. Letty, is that you there with that Raiders shirt on?
I was a young Raider fan then, and I'm an older Raider fan now. Yes.
Any Raider fans out there? One.
Hey,
one.
No booing.
That was 50 years ago. Some of that stuff going 50 years. Can I hear an amen for all those over 65?
Amen.
The other one's like, what are they talking about? Well, praise the Lord. God has a plan for us, and it's interesting to look back and see how what we thought was God's plan turned out not to be that way. So I'm excited about that. Well, I'm excited. Karen, do you want to look in the mirror and see what's going on?
No. I'll wait till Monday with the ladies. Once is enough.
Okay. Praise the Lord. All right. Well, have a good day. Hey, wait, Karen, I want to look in there and see what Pastor Ed got me for Valentine's Day in 2021. Okay, here you go. Here's our disclaimer. We changed the names to protect the innocent.
It went from Eddie to Eduardo. So it wasn't Pastor Ed.
We're trying to be funny, but we're just trying to invite all the ladies to come. We have a good time at the meetings. We have fellowship. We're going to have soup and salad. You're going to be served. We're going to have drawings. You're going to win some great prizes, and we're going to have some rich word. So sign up. We need you to sign up so we know exactly how many are coming. We'll meet up in Hebrews. We're going to start right at 6:30 sharp, so get here a little bit early and praise the Lord. Thank you. This is a hard crowd this morning, Pastor Ed.
Hard crowd, huh? Praise the Lord. Thank you, ladies. Hallelujah. The guy's name wasn't Bobby either that she was thinking about. Because I know everything about her previous boyfriends. But that's all right. God forgave her, so did I. Amen? All I can tell them is you lost and I won. Hallelujah. So praise the name of the Lord. Well, some of you that have signed up for college, I don't know if you noticed the difference. Instead of having two classes on Tuesday night, we're only going to have one. We changed it to Undercover by John Bevere. It's his college course on authority. So that class is going to be on Tuesday nights, and then we have Ministry of the Holy Spirit on Thursday. So Tuesday morning classes still remain the same. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And again, about the college, folks, you can take the classes, And it just costs you $25 if you just want to take the class, receive the material, and just grow and learn. Or you can pay $75 and get three college credits for your taking the class, and you can earn all the way to a doctorate's degree here in our college. So anyway, come and be a part of that. Amen? Sign up for the marriage class in the back. And marriage on the rock is not just for marriages that are having problems. It's about how to continue to grow in marriage and make your marriage richer and richer and richer. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, God bless you all. Let's get into the Word of God as we dismiss our children and let them go to the classes. And as our ushers bring the tithes and the offerings forward, let's open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 24 so we're ready to go. Hallelujah. Pastor Gary's going to pray over the tithes and offerings.
Father, we just come before you this morning in an attitude of love. I thank you, Lord, that you said that the sower sows the word, and that's what we're going to do right now is simply sow this word, your word, over the tithes and offerings. We thank you that this is our covenant connector, Lord. This puts us into the place that we are able to continue to receive all the promises that Jesus Christ did at the cross. He said it was a finished work, Lord, so everything that we will ever have need of is literally tied to our being obedient to be a tither and a giver under your direction and leading. So I thank you, Lord, that as we have brought this as an expression of our trust in you, as an expression of our love for you, that you will bless each and every giver, Lord, that you will see to it that the windows of heaven are open, that you will see to it that the devourer is rebuked in their lives, that you will see to it that you will watch over them, put a hedge around them, protect us, and just give you all the glory because you're the only one who can do this. And we praise you and thank you in Jesus Christ's precious and holy name. And the church said,
amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, happy Valentine's Day to everybody. How many have a Valentine? How many are praying for one? A few have late raised their hands. Praise God. Well, we're in agreement with you that God will send your soulmate. Amen? Praise the name of the Lord. Again, Matthew chapter 24. I'm excited about what God's doing in our lives. Hallelujah. I'm excited about what's happening in the world, even though our world is sort of turning upside down. That just tells us that God is turning his church right side up. And that he's getting us ready for his coming. And so we just need to be prepared spiritually inside of ourselves. Amen?
Amen.
I mean, you know, if you watch everything out here, you'll get discouraged. You know, there'll be instances of good things happening, but you'll get discouraged overall listening to what the world is saying and doing. But if you listen to what God is doing, you'll never be discouraged. If you look at what God is doing, how his hand is moving, you'll always be full of joy and excitement for each and every day that you have to face. No matter what the difficulty is, you know your God is great enough to see you through. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, today we're going to continue on our series called Out of Darkness, but the subtitle of this is Misinformation Leads to Destruction. Amen?
Amen.
I mean, if you don't hear things right or understand things right, you'll make wrong decisions. Amen? If you let your human emotion guide you, you'll make wrong decisions. If you let your human desires, what you feel you want to have in your life, lead you, you're going to make wrong decisions. So we have to make the right thing. And the awesome thing about God is he's made us the children of the Most High God by our confession of faith. We're born again. We have the right to hear the voice of God.
Amen.
We have the ability to hear the voice of God. And God may not speak to you like I'm speaking to you today, but you're still going to hear a still small voice, or you're going to feel an unction inside of you, a leadership of the Spirit of God, or the Word of God itself is going to just leap off of that page and get written in your heart and renews your mind. Amen? But God's going to communicate to you in some fashion, in some way that you are open to. Because God knows which doors are closed, and he knows which door is open, which avenue he can take to get to you, to get you the truth, so the truth can set you free. Amen?
Hallelujah.
So just praise God and start thanking him that he is going to minister to you.
Yeah.
And start leading us and taking the church further and further away from carnality and into the depth of his Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Now, again, folks, when we say out of carnality, it's not that I think we're all rank sinners and we're doing horrible things, but how many of you know there's some things we do that we don't even recognize as sin? Sometimes just wasting our time, we just think we're having fun, and yet God would say, hey, you could have spent that time enriching yourself in your spirit, because God knows what's coming down the road, and he wants you to be able to endure it, stand, and go through it. So he says, you could have been strengthening yourself, and anything not of faith is sin. Amen? So God wants us to always be increasing in faith, always growing in the knowledge of the Lord. That's what he is to us. That's how we came to know him. He revealed himself to us. And once he did, we confessed him as Lord and Savior, and our life was changed. Well, as we continue to study his word and pray and seek him, he continues to reveal himself in deeper and deeper ways. And we just grow, and we overcome things in our lives, and our character gets changed. Amen? As I've always said, we all were characters. But now we can get some character, amen? We can be changed by God, by the renewing of our mind. But we have to apply ourselves to get into his word. Because if you don't know what his word says, there's a lot of misinformation out there that's going to cause you to miss what God is doing. For instance, here in Matthew chapter 24, it says this, and Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. First off, there's a warning that as the last days approach, that there's going to be a deceiving spirit that comes upon the world. And he's literally speaking this to the church. He's speaking it to his disciples. So he says there's a deceiving spirit going to come against the church to get to the church so that they believe the lie and not the truth. Amen? Well, one of those things is that, you know, that it's being, you know, spoken of so much is that you don't have to repent anymore. And that's not necessary, and yet that's totally against what the Word of God says. God says, confess your sins, and he's faithful and just to cleanse you from all your unrighteousness and all your iniquity. God tells us to walk holy because he is holy, amen? And yet there's a teachings out there that says, you know, you can live like the world and be okay with God, and that's not true, amen? You may still make it into heaven, but God in Corinthians says, as though by fire, amen? How many would like to go to heaven by fire, or how many would like to go to heaven by the glory of God? Yeah. Amen. I think I'd rather go the easy way. Yeah. Amen. How many think the easy way is better? Raise your hand. Yeah. If your hand's broken, we'll pray that God heals it. But we want to go the easy way. Amen. And the easy way is to be obedient to God now, to respond to his word now. Hallelujah. So he says that there's going to be those that want to deceive you. For many will come in my name. In other words, they're going to be teachers and prophets of the Word of God, apostles, whatever they have chosen to deem themselves. How many of you know a lot of prophets deem themselves a prophet? And folks, a true prophet is when his prophecies come to pass. There's a lot of, quote, prophets that are prophesying, and when their prophecy doesn't come to pass, they try to change it and say, well, now it's this and now it's that. Well, in the old days, if a prophet missed it, they just stoned him to death. He didn't get to correct his prophecy. Amen? So we have to be aware that there are things going out, and this scripture, these scriptures we're going to read, is literally telling us, beware of prophets. Not that there's not good ones, but there's going to be a lot of bad ones because they're out to deceive. It's the enemy. And listen, they're going to do it with all sincerity, folks. They're going to believe what they're saying. They're sold out to what they think. But folks, how do we measure everything in our lives? By the Word of God, period. By the Word of God, nothing else. We have to measure it, amen? Any prophecy given by anyone, any teaching given by anyone has to line up with the Word of God. Hallelujah. So he says they're going to be out there saying that I am the Christ and will deceive many. Then if you look over in verse 23, it says this about what's going to happen. Then if anyone says to you, look, here is Christ, or there, do not believe it, for false Christs and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. Now, folks, they are going to be so dynamic in their way and so energizing in their way, they're going to try to pump people up into a frenzy, if you will, of worship and praise of God. First off, folks, I want to say something to all of you and listen very closely. All the prophets in the Old Testament didn't have a band with them. They didn't whip people into a frenzy to get them excited about what was going to be said. Jesus, when he walked, didn't have a band with him. There was no praise and worship going on when he was ministering and prophesying the word of God. Amen. The apostles did not have a band with them everywhere they went. They simply spoke the word of God, and it was so powerful that people were healed, set free, delivered. Nations were changed by the power of God. Amen. So, first clue for all of you, listen, if it's a hype, you better listen very closely to what's going on around you, because it's one of the ways the enemy comes in. After all, Lucifer, Satan, the power of darkness that's guiding false prophets, who was he? He led all of God's creation in worship of God. He was a praise and worship leader. He used music to entice and to cause people to get seduced. Amen. God says in the last days, there are going to be the same type of thing happening on the face of the earth. So folks, I'm not telling you that because you went to a meeting or you've been in a meeting where there was music that it's wrong. We have music ourselves, but we try not to make it a hype. We're just singing praises of God. We're singing about the glory of our God. That's it. Amen. Some of you want more things to happen. Listen, the Spirit will move when you decide to allow the Spirit to move you. So, here's the word of the Lord. Many false prophets will rise up and show great signs. There will be manifestations. But, again, what happened in the times of Moses? When Moses went to Pharaoh, the very first miracle that Moses did by throwing down his staff, what did the magicians of Egypt do? They threw down their staffs. Their staffs turned into cobras also. That was a lying sign and a lying miracle. God's cobra, obviously, was a little bit bigger and a little bit better because he swallowed all theirs. Amen? But listen to me. The enemy can make things happen, and so you cannot be moved just because of what you're seeing with the natural eye. You have to be able to see it in the Spirit of the living God and know what is happening around you. So, therefore, you have to be strong in the Word. You have to be strong in the word because it says the very elect would be deceived if possible. What does it mean if possible the elect would be deceived? It means God is going to intervene in the elect's lives. It means God is for you and not against you. That means God, if you're studying and you're praying and you're watching God and you're listening to God and you are conforming to his word, not asking his word to conform to you, but you to conform to his word, you have become one of the very elect. And it's still going to depend upon the sustaining wisdom and revelation you're receiving from God to keep you from falling into the deceiving power of the enemy. Amen? So you have to draw close to the Lord, and thank God the doors are open for us to draw close to the Lord. Amen? Thank God we have ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying to us. Thank God we're the children of the Most High God. Thank God he put it in writing for us. Hallelujah. So if you get confused, you can come back and read it again. Amen. Hallelujah. God has equipped us to be able to stand in these last days and to endure. Amen? There's not only going to be persecution coming against us, but deception of a great magnitude, the greatest magnitude in the history of the world. Hallelujah. That's what the Word of God says. There's never going to be a time of deception like there's going to be in the last days. And folks, it's happening right now in our nation and across the world. And so again, as a pastor, I'm telling my church, please get into the Word of God. Please get into prayer. If you don't understand, call someone who does and ask them. Call me. I'm happy to help you. Take the classes and be taught the Word of the Lord so that you can stand in these last days. All you're doing is enriching yourself. Amen. If you look at the study as making a dollar, if you look at studying as making a dollar, did y'all understand that? In other words, you're going to get something out of it. For your time invested, things are going to be invested from heaven into you. And heavenly things last forever, and earthly things are temporal. So God is saying, invest in your own life, because there's a deception coming that wants to steal your investment, that wants to steal what God has established inside of you by deceiving you and taking away the promises of God. Amen? For instance, folks, how many have heard of GameStop this last couple of weeks? You know, it's a stock, and a bunch of people on the internet got on and started buying it, and they drove the price up to 400 and something a share when it was only a $20 a share company. And people were just jumping in because they thought, I'm going to get rich quick, and they were buying. And well, there was a young man back east. He had $1 million, and he bought GameStop when it was really high, thinking it would go higher. Then it plummeted and went down to nothing. And he committed suicide not because he lost his money. He didn't understand. He had misinformation on how the stock market works. You don't lose money until you sell the stock. You still own the same stock. You don't lose money just because it goes down. You lose it when you sell it when it's down. He thought in his mind, because this is what he had been taught, if my stock goes down, I have to pay back the amount of money that it dropped. He thought he owed $740,000 to the agency, to the trader. And he said, I've lost $1 million. The only thing I had, now I owe $740,000. And he killed himself. That was misinformation, and it led to destruction in his life. Because he could have held on to the stock, and maybe 10 years from now, it might be worth $700 a share. He could have made money, but he thought he owed money, but he didn't. He still had the asset. It just wasn't worth as much, and some people would kill themselves over that. But misinformation led him to make a decision that caused him to lose his life. Well, as Christians, I don't want any of us, because of misinformation, to change our life or what we're doing or what we're expecting and then find out that that wasn't so. And all of a sudden, we have ourselves in trouble and in a predicament, and our emotions are running wild, and we don't know what to do with our lives. That's why the Bible was written. That's why Jesus came to us, so that we could understand the heavenly kingdom and how it operates and how it supersedes the kingdoms of this world, so that we can always be stable, immovable, rock solid in God. No matter what's happening in the world, we know that God is our source and our supply. We know that God will always correct us if we're going a wrong way. But again, if you don't have that understanding, you're going to think that I've lost it all. You're going to think that I'm not worthy. You're going to think that God has forsaken me. And that's not true. You still have, quote, the stock in Jesus Christ. Because you didn't sell your soul to the enemy. You still have stock in Christ Jesus, and he's going to give you the strength to be the glory and the lifter of your head in the midst of a devastating time in your life. Amen. And he'll give you the ability not only to go through it, but on the other side, not smell like smoke, not be destroyed, but find the answer in the promises of God, and God can restore the abundant life back to you. Because God loves you. God desires you to love him so much that you want to know more about him. Hallelujah. You want to know more about him. Folks, I've been studying the Word of God since I'm 13. And I tell you, I still love studying the Word of God, because there's always something new God gives me that he adds to what I already have had from God or received from God, or he refreshes something that I have forgotten, and it reinvigorates me and keeps me excited about my walk with God. Hallelujah. And my desire to please him in my life. And yes, how many have fallen into sin and missed it as a Christian? The rest of you will have a counseling class right after the service. Because we've all done it. I've done it. Every one of us have fallen into sin as Christians. But thank God, God is the renewer of our soul. He turns us from wickedness to righteousness. And he is a forgiving God who washes our sins away, never to look upon them again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So folks, God is calling us out of the darkness and saying, children, come be more like me. Come be filled with more of my glory, more of my wisdom, more of my love, more of my compassion, my mercy and grace. And watch not only how it changes how you interact with people, but look how it changes you and you feel more at peace within yourself. Because your peace isn't in what you have. Your peace is in who you have. And all of a sudden, there is a comfortability that even if all this gets shaken, this doesn't get shaken. This is steadfast and immovable in Christ. Hallelujah. So God gives us a warning that there's going to be a lot of deceiving happening in the last days. A lot of people saying that this is what Christ taught, this is what Christ did, this is what Christ has prophesied for today because I'm prophesying through him. And God is saying, measure it, weigh it, and make sure it is accurate. Make sure it is not accurate to what you want, but accurate to what God's word says. So I'm going to give you this warning. Right now, there's people prophesying that God's going to do a great move and turn our country around. And folks, we all prayed for that. We wanted Mr. Trump, President Trump, to be reelected. We believed that God was going to do it. The prophets had prophesied it, but it didn't happen. And what has happened is what we're seeing that was prophesied back in Ezekiel and in Jeremiah and Isaiah, what the Old Testament prophets said would be happening in the last days is exactly what we're seeing happening. If you want to know what's happening now, I would say this, before you listen to a modern day prophet, go back and listen to the old time prophets. Because everything is established on the old time prophets and the apostles. You come back to them, you get the foundation, now you can move forward and make right judgments about what you believe is going to happen in the last days. You know what God told me about the two fronts coming in? They were all designed to destroy the systems that we are used to. The systems that we lived in, that gave us freedom of religion. What we're seeing is there's a change, a transition, a weakening, a breaking, and it's going to continue. So we just need to be prepared, folks. And you can say, well, Pastor, how do we know you're not a false prophet? Well, you can go back to the Old Testament and study the Word and see if the Word doesn't say the systems of the world are going to change so the Antichrist can come up. Go to the book of Revelation and you can literally read it almost word for word that there's going to be a movement of evil and a movement of God and everything in this world is going to change. So weigh the Word, because before I ever share it, I weigh what God gives me. I'm not trying to convince you I'm right. Just get in and study it. And if you come to me and say I'm wrong, I'll get back in and study it again. And I'm man enough to get up here in front of all of you and say I miss God. Just that simple. Because, folks, listen, it's not about me and it's not about you. It's about truth. It's about Jesus. And if we're not bold enough to say we're wrong, then we need to not be in a position to say anything. Hallelujah. I did believe there was going to be great chaos in our streets, greater than we saw. I believed it. I didn't hear it from God, but I believed it. The prophets prophesied it. Didn't happen, but yet there's still chaos happening in our streets. I believed we were supposed to get food and stuff stored up. We did it. And as I told you then, if we're wrong about all this, we got lots of food to help a lot of people. Hallelujah. Amen. I got a lot of food to give a lot of people. Because a lot of the food I bought, it's getting ready to expire in about 3 more months. So I need to get it out and get some people fed. Hallelujah. So again, folks, being with God is not that you are perfect. It's that you're on the road to perfection. And that you're listening to God and you're really digging in to get to know him better. Amen? That's the simple gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus basically said this, I'm going to come and die for you, pay the price for your sins so I can introduce you to my Father. And so that you understand what my Father is going to say to you through his living word, I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit who shall be your teacher. And the Holy Spirit shall teach you and tell you everything that I have, what was given to me, what's been given to you, and he's going to reveal the Father's heart to you. Hallelujah. That's simply the gospel in a nutshell, folks. He not only wanted to save you, he wants to have a deep relationship with you. And he wants you to understand heaven and how it works, because that's where you're a citizen now. Hallelujah. How many are glad you're a citizen of heaven? And you know, it doesn't take a passport. Hallelujah. You just say, Jesus, come in my life, and all of a sudden you're in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Doesn't take a passport. It takes believing that Jesus Christ died for you. Hallelujah. Turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 13. But evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Evil men are not only deceiving, because people will think, well, even evil men purpose to deceive you. This scripture, when you read it in the Greek, literally says, men have become evil because they have been deceived and therefore are deceiving others. It's that they became evil because they were deceived. Amen? The lie came and captured their heart, and they became evil, and now they're deceiving, but in their heart, they don't see themselves as evil. They see themselves as a sharing a truth that's going to help you. Amen? For instance, the Kingdom Now teaching that is still being lifted up in this nation and around the world. The Kingdom Now teaching is this. You are all going to get so filled with the Spirit, so knowledgeable in the Word, that you're all going to be perfected so much that God looks down from heaven and says, wow, that looks like heaven. I'm going to go live there. That's Kingdom Now teaching, in a nutshell, if you will. That you're going to get so glorious, God's going to say, why would I stay in heaven when I can have all this? Doesn't hold true in the Word of God. The Word of God doesn't say anything like that. The Word of God says He's going to melt this earth. He's going to utterly destroy it, melt it with fervent heat, and create a new heaven and a new earth. Amen? Hallelujah. So, again, deception, but they're very sincere. And so when they prophesy, they just prophesy how good and great you're going to be, and how good the country's going to be, and how good the world is going to be. Well, folks, I don't know about you, but I look at the world and it's worse off than it was. Amen. 20 years ago, it was a holier place than it is now. Amen. 50 years, it was really a holier place than it was now. Hallelujah. We had great crusades going on across this nation 50 years ago, 60, 70 years ago, and people were being won by the thousands. Amen. Because men believed in the Word of God. Yes. Hallelujah. Now there's such a compromise in the Word because we're so compromised with the world. We want what the world has and we want what God has, but that's a contradiction. That's a contradiction. You can't have what the world has and have what God has until you get what God has, and then He can give you all things and it won't affect the way you live. You'll still live holy. You'll still live in love with God. You'll still live performing His purposes and His ways. Amen? Amen? It's not that God doesn't want you to have. How many are glad you have what you have? How many are happy you got what you got? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. There's nothing wrong with having. There's nothing wrong with having an abundance. Amen. The thing is you just got to get everything right with God. Seeking Him, hearing from Him. Otherwise, there's deception in the things of the world. Amen? You just got to be paying the attention and giving the time that is necessary to know your God better than you ever knew Him before. You know, your goal and my goal is to know Him a little bit more today than I knew yesterday. And on Monday, to know Him a little bit better than I knew Him today. And on Tuesday, to know Him a little bit better than I did Monday. You should always be moving towards God. Amen? Amen? But here's what we do, folks, and I've said it so many times, but we start moving towards God, and then comes Monday, and we move back towards the world. And then comes Wednesday, and we make a little jump, but we're still not where we used to be. And then comes the Thursday and Friday and Saturday, and we're way over here. And it's not that you're in gross sin or doing, you know, terrible things. Your heart's just not beating for God like it was way back over there 2 weeks ago. You're not hungry after God like you were. I mean, you know, if you don't eat, you lose appetite. Eventually, you'll lose appetite. Go on a fast for like 12 days. At the end of 12 days, man, you ain't hungry for nothing. Your breath smells as fresh as baby breath. I mean, all of a sudden, your strength comes back, and you're just saying, glory to God, I don't need to eat, man. I'm just strong as an ox. Then when you hit the 23rd day, oh, God, I'm dying. Get me something to eat. You'll lose your appetite for God within just a couple of weeks if you don't continue to stimulate it, if you don't continue to stir it, because the world has the ability to take your appetite away because it gives you another appetite. Amen? Amen. I said amen? Amen. My mama used to make me fried bologna sandwiches. I thought that was the best sandwich on earth. A bologna sandwich, a fried bologna sandwich with Miracle Whip, not mayonnaise. And I thought it was awesome until I tasted a turkey sandwich. Till I tasted something else, and all of a sudden I had an appetite for that, and I don't have an appetite for bologna. Thank God, yes. And I'm not saying it's a bad food. It's just after I tasted something that had more flavor and the texture I like, I had a different appetite. Well, the enemy knows how to stir up your earthly appetites to get you away from God and what God is saying. I'm giving you warning, deception is coming. So guard yourself and protect yourself so that darkness doesn't take you a couple of steps deeper into darkness, but let the light of the Lord take you a couple steps deeper into the light of God. Amen? Hallelujah. So again, he just simply speaks to us and he says, there's going to be people out there deceiving you, and it's because they're deceived. Now again, why would God tell us they're deceived? Because he doesn't want you to judge them. Those liars, those hypocrites, those false prophets, he doesn't want you to judge them and be critical. He wants you to fall on your knees and pray for them, that God removes their blinders so that they're not deceived, so that they can find the truth and walk in the fullness of salvation that God offers. He's trying to give you his compassionate heart that we all need to have one for another, because I've heard this throughout all my life as a Christian, is somebody judging another Christian for something they said or they did. They hurt me, they wounded me, they deceived me. You know, I'll never do business with a Christian because they stick me. Well, folks, if they stuck you, quit worrying about the money you lost and think about this. That person must be deceived to think that that is okay. I need to get on my knees and intercede for them because they're trapped in the snare of the enemy. And if it took me losing that to become an intercessor for them, then glory to God, I'll pay the cost. Because I'm supposed to build the house of the Lord, not tear down the things. Amen. Amen. Again, we have to get to the point where we're not letting what's happening here upset our equilibrium in the spirit, if you will. We need to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. And when something happens wrong out here, instead of worrying about our loss, our hurt, our wound, we should only think about the other person and how we can help turn their life around, because they need insight from God. They need someone praying for them. So he says, evil men became evil and they are deceiving because they are deceived. Amen? So he's telling us how to pray and intercede for this world and our brothers and sisters in the Lord. Amen? I can't tell you how many people have left churches because they got hurt in the church they were in. And so they went and found another church. They're going around looking for the perfect church. And like I've always said, as soon as you walk in, it's no longer perfect. Hallelujah. There is no perfect church. There is no perfect pastor. There is no perfect congregation. The only congregation you should be sitting in is the one God plants you in. And you're going to find a lot of things that you may say is not perfect. But then why is God revealing that to you? So you can pray to help it get better. To put your hand to work in it, to help it get better. Yes. Hallelujah. Because is there anyone in this room that thinks they're perfect? I mean, don't let pride hold you back. Is there anyone in here thinks they're perfect? Okay, that's good. Praise the Lord, because I don't think I'm perfect. I ask my wife, honey, am I perfect? And she just laughs. She knows I ain't, I know I'm not perfect. She tells me. Oh, you told me last night, honey. Yeah, you said, don't talk to me with that voice up that high. Yeah, it was yesterday. I sort of yelled at you, huh? Yeah. So as soon as she said that, I knew I wasn't perfect. But you know what that did? It made me madder. I wanted to yell all the more. Okay. You are a hard crowd to get laughing or anything out here today. Listen, none of us are perfect. We're all in the work of the Lord. And God says he's not going to stop until he has perfected us or until we meet him in the air. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we're all being worked on. Hallelujah. Now, you can either help him work on you, which would be easier for you, or you can resist the work of the Lord, and sometimes he's just got to hit you on the head. He's got to really chisel something off of you, amen? And all of a sudden something happens and God gets your attention and says, now are you going to change? Amen? So again, deception is in the air. How many of you thought today when you got up, man, spring is in the air. What a beautiful day it was. It is, amen? Charlton said it twice before we got in the car. What a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. I thought she was going to start singing. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. Oh, my goodness. You guys are hard. Stan, you're a singer. Get up here and sing for us. Get this crowd going. I can't get them. The word of the Lord, folks, is so alive, so powerful, so wonderful. We should be wanting to get in it and be changed every day. Amen. Because there's deception in the air trying to keep us from reaching our destiny in God. But we're overcomers through Christ. We're more than conquerors because we know where to set our eyes on the author and the finisher of our faith. We know where to judge every word. It's in the word of the living God. We know who to go to get answers. We go to our Lord and Savior and ask in his name that the Father give us wisdom and revelation. We are the children of the Most High God, and we have been changed and transformed that we can hear from God, be changed by God, be used by God for the glory of God. So don't let the deception take us away, but it says it's going to be so strong, even the very elect, if possible, would be deceived. In other words, the best of the best. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. How many in your heart, you don't have to raise your hand because we don't want you to be attacked for raising. How many think in yourself, I'm the best of the best? How many think I'm the mediocre of the mediocre? Still no hands raised. The thing is God's saying, where are you? Where are you at in your personal growth with me? Deception is coming. You need to know where you're at and start preparing yourself to be where you need to be. Amen? Isn't that why they give our children tests in school? They give them a test not to be mean. They give them a test to see where they're at in their learning abilities so that they can help them grow and learn in those subject matters. Amen? A test is to help you, not to hurt you. You need to evaluate. You need to do a heavenly test and say, what's coming out of my mouth? What's coming out of my mouth when I'm under pressure? Where do I run to when pressure gets on me? When things are going good, who am I talking to? Am I talking to the Lord? Am I studying with my spare time? And listen, you shouldn't use spare time. You should have dedicated time. What am I doing with my life to get better with God? You're not going to get any more saved, but you're going to grow in knowledge of the Lord, which makes you a useful tool in the hands of God, which causes His blessings to flow upon you in greater and greater waves of glory. Hallelujah. So here in Timothy, again, he says, listen, I want you to even have compassion on the wicked and pray for them, because if no one prays for them, what's going to happen? Didn't Jesus come and die even for the wicked? Because you and I were wicked before we got saved. Amen? And he tells us to lay down our lives one for another. So laying down my life for the righteous is nothing. Laying down my life for the wicked is everything. And when I say laying down for the righteous is nothing, we're supposed to do that one for another. But the greatest impact is to lay down our life for our brothers that are evil and wicked and captured and deceived and lost and heading for eternal damnation. Amen? What are we doing? How are we helping them realize that God is really real? Our outreach that we're going to be doing, and the meeting, and the fair that we're going to be doing, and the feeding that we're going to continue to do. Why are we doing that? So that the lost knows there's an answer in Jesus Christ. What are you doing to be a part of it? Are you financially helping it? Are you coming and working it? Are you going to be a counselor in it? Are you going to be a Bible study teacher for it? Are you going to be a connect person to help draw them into the church? What are you going to do to reach the lost? Amen? You got to evaluate. What's my life about? What's your life? Is it all about me? Then at least you ought to join the choir. Because even the choir goes, me, 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 me. You'd be good at it. If your life is all about me, then you'd be great in the choir. This is German humor, so if you're not German, you're probably not getting it. I don't know. Anyway, praise the Lord. God is telling us that we need to draw close to Him because deception is coming, and you don't want to be deceived, so draw closer. Amen. Stop doing some of the things you're doing that has no eternal value, and start doing some things that have eternal value. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Colossians chapter 2. Praise the name of the Lord. You see, when you study His word, what happens? Faith comes. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. All of a sudden, your belief system is strengthened. Your belief system is like your immune system. And right now, folks, what's the world talking about? You have to have an immunity to this virus and all the diseases that are around the world. You need to have a strong immunity system. Amen? Because if your immune system is weak, you're open to receive all types of virus and bacteria and plagues. All of that can come against you. Amen? 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 Faith is the immune system of heaven. If you're not reading the Word of God, your immune system is weak. And you're going to be susceptible to all the viruses of deception. Because you're going to make God in your box. You're going to make God what you want Him to be rather than what God says He is. And you may find out that your God in your box is not sufficient to carry you through in the last times when you're being tested and tried. And folks, listen, every one of us, whether we're here when Jesus comes or not, are going through our last times. You only live for so long. So you need to make sure you're not being deceived so that you are a child of God that enters heaven, not as 1 Corinthians says, as by fire. Amen. God says many are going to enter heaven as though through fire. They're going to be crispy little critters. They make it to heaven, but I've told you they're going to be like Rice Krispies. When you pour milk over Rice Krispies, what do they do? Snap, crackle, pop. What does something that's been burnt do? Snap, crackle, and pop. I see a whole bunch of Christians when I read that scripture. I see a whole bunch of Christians standing over in the corner. They've made it into heaven. And you hear this. And you look over and here's a bunch of people. I made it. But they're popping and cracking because they had to go through fire to get there. Amen? But God says you don't have to go that way. Build on the foundation. Amen. With gold and silver and rubies and diamonds, which are the truths of God's word. It is the character of God and the nature of God that he's causing you to be. You can make it into heaven and you'll take your crowns off and throw them at the feet of Jesus and bow down and worship him. God wants us to be a people that are truly at peace when we take our last breath and go home, because we know we've done the will of the Lord. We know that we're really super close to him. And that there's no fear in us whatsoever as we face death, because death has no victory. Hallelujah. Chapter 2 and verse 4. Now this I say, lest anyone should deceive you with persuasive words. Hallelujah. I know people that tell, I'll never be deceived. I'll never be deceived. I'll never be deceived. And then someone comes along with some pretty words. And they go after it hook, line, and sinker, because that's what they wanted to hear. They're like the fish that sees the bait, the lure, and it looks like it's dinner. Because it's shiny. But they don't swim beside it and check it out. They just swim up and grab it. And all of a sudden, they're caught. A lot of people are that way. They don't check things out. You know, at least swim by it and see what it's like. You know, that's one of, I don't like sharks. I mean, I love sharks, but I don't want to be in the water with them. But one thing I like about a great white shark, in a lot of instances, they swim by to see what that is that they're looking at. They'll even bump up against it to see the reaction and what it is before they ever turn around to take a bite, in many cases. Because they want to make sure they're not going to get injured. And when they take a bite out of a great big sea lion, they bite it and immediately swim away because they know that thing's still going to be fighting and thrashing, and they just let it bleed to death before they come back to eat it. Because they use wisdom. I'm not going to consume all this thing till I know I'm not going to get hurt. Christians, seems like they just go along and consume anything that sounds good, sounds right. Oh, that's for me. That's what I've been praying for. Well, what's the word of God say that Satan comes as? An angel of light. Comes, I'm bearing good gifts. What's the false prophets do? Lying miracles and wonders. That's what I've been looking for. The wonders and the miracles. Amen. Check them out. Check them out. I said, check them out.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When I hear a man prophesy, I try to find out what his life has been. When I hear he's been married 3 times, I immediately say, well, I'm not coming against people that have gotten divorced and remarried, but a prophet's not supposed to be doing that. If he can't even keep his life in line, how's he telling me he hears from God? Okay. You can get mad at me if you want to. That's all right. I try to find out what's been going on in their lives. Because before I weigh their prophecy, I want to weigh their life. You should be doing that. I'm a pastor with one wife. No mistresses. No girlfriends. No friends with benefits. No boyfriends. What's the word of God say? A pastor should be a man of one wife. He must can have his house under control. All 3 of my boys serve the living God. My grandchildren serve the living God. And I'm married to one woman only, and I will be married to her until the day I die. Weigh my life. Have I made mistakes in my life? Yes, I will tell you right up front, I have been a jerk in my life. I have sinned big time and I have repented. I'm not saying a guy has to be perfect, but let's see the lifestyle. Folks, that's one of your first clues to not getting deceived. Check the lifestyle of the person that's saying, yes, God can use a donkey. We'll use the other term that's in the Bible. And this is not a derogatory term. It is in the Bible. He used an ass. So sometimes he will still do that. So, again, I'm not trying to be funny for funny's sake, but let's get it. We're not, none of us are perfect. Sometimes he has to use one. But again, you have to measure it and make sure you're listening to the right one. Because every one of them have a different sound. We're going to have a spirit of laughter, and it ain't going to be the Holy Spirit. It's going to be something else. Anyway, praise the Lord. Let's go back here. How many of you know you can have fun in God? I mean, you know, church doesn't have to be boring. It can be challenging, and it should be challenging, but it don't have to be boring. Amen. Now I say, lest any of you should be deceived with persuasive words, for though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and steadfastness of your faith in Christ. What are the leaders of the body of Christ supposed to be looking for? Your steadfastness and your orderly life. Amen? That's what we should be rejoicing in. You're growing in the Lord, and the order of your life is starting to get in God's order. And you're becoming steadfast so that you cannot be deceived. That's the purpose of ministry, to teach you the truth, no matter whether you want to hear it or not, but to teach the truth in such a way that you will receive it, let it become life, so that you will not be deceived and that your life will become under the order of God. That's the whole purpose of ministry in a nutshell again. I'm giving you the Reader's Digest over a lot of things today to just let you know this is how simple it is with God. There's a lot of deception in the world, but God is looking for people who have their lives in order according to His Word, led by His Spirit, and that they have become steadfast and immovable so that their ear is inclined to Him rather than to the deception of the world and false religion. Amen. Hallelujah. So He says, we're rejoicing. Man, there's happiness. You know, I can tell you, I'm a happy pastor. Because I see God doing things in the lives of my people. Sometimes I see my people and I even see me go the wrong way, but thank God, God allows U-turns. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. How many of you go somewhere and you miss the street you're supposed to turn on? Yeah, I even have a lady in my car that talks to me. It's not my wife. I mean, she talks to me too. But I have another voice in my car. Recalculating the directions. Make a U-turn as soon as possible. Because you idiot, you missed your turn. The other day, Sharon and I, we were just, we knew where we were going. We're just driving, we're just talking. I'm just talking. All of a sudden, I'm five blocks past where I was supposed to turn. And I said, what street? Well, I actually turned on the wrong street. I said, what street are we on? I don't even know where I'm at. I've never been on this street. And I've been all over Bakersfield. Well, if it's that easy to do it in the natural, how many of you think it could be easy to do it in the spiritual if you're not feasting on the Word of God? And then what happens to this relationship? It's not on the rock, it gets rocky. And then we start playing the music because I know I'm right. Dun, 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 dun. I'm in a great mood today. Have any of you noticed? Just in it, I just got this joy bubbling up inside of me. It's just fun. Hallelujah. Because when we get in a fight, I know I'm going to win. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. See how deceived I am? I thought I won.
I love you too, honey. Be my Valentine. Hallelujah. For though I'm absent in the flesh, but so the, what he's saying is, and I'll say it to you. How many of you know I'm not with you 24 hours a day? How many of you are glad I'm not with you 24 hours a day? So, but I know something. The word of God will never return void, but always accomplish that which it set out to do. So though I'm absent in my body from you, I'm rejoicing that God's doing something great in you. And I'm continuing to pray that God opens your eyes and gives you understanding. I pray the apostolic prayers over my church. Amen? I pray that. I pray that you'll know your inheritance in God. I pray that you'll know the power that he's given unto usward who believe. I pray that you'll know your calling in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Because every one of you got a calling. You got something very specific God wants you to do. Amen. Hallelujah. God says there's deception in these last days. Hallelujah. There's deception in these last days. How many ever thought, as Charlene did in the little skit today, I thought I was going to marry Bobby. His name was Earl, in case you forgot.
What about Alan?
And Alan and Steve. Honey, we don't want to air all that out right now. She was my one and only. I was not hers. Huh? You changed the names to protect them? I don't want to protect them, those dirty dogs. I do. I pray for them. Anyway, folks, so much deception in the world. We need to just really get excited about our God, because he is a phenomenal God. There's so much to know about him, so much he wants to do inside of us and do for us and do through us, that every day is a great adventure. And again, I liken it to, you know, what we do in the world. You know, people get excited because they got a new deal, or they buy a new house, or they get a new car. You know, and that's in sort of investing in your life, although a car doesn't really invest. But that's where deception comes. Amen. But the word is like investing in your life, getting the things you want for your life, like peace that passes all understanding, able to guard your heart and your mind. Like getting compassion for all the people you love and care for, true compassion that will reach out with God's hand. Like getting compassion for the lost that are hurting and crying because they don't have anybody that really truly does love them. And they need to know the love of God. They need to know the love of a Christian in God. Amen. The joy of seeing your children and your grandchildren know Jesus Christ as Lord. So many things this word just brings into your life. Because it teaches you to pray for them, teaches you to love them without compromise, teaches you not even to judge the wicked, but give them a glass of water in the name of Jesus and pray for them. Takes away the anger out of your heart, takes away the criticisms, takes away the turmoil of all the stuff that this world wants to place inside of you. We don't need to be deceived because we serve the God of all wisdom, of all knowledge, of all truth. We just need to rejoice in that and say, you know what? I'm going to dedicate my life to knowing more and more of that God, receiving of his heavenly benefits. And God will take care of all this. He'll make the way for you. Jesus came to bless us. He knows we need to eat. He knows you need clothing. He knows you need a house over your head. He said, I take care of the sparrows, don't I? I make the lilies beautiful, don't I? I take care of them and they don't have to toil or anything. God loves us. And let's not let this deceiving spirit take us away from our real purpose, and that's just to draw close to him. Draw close to him. Know the truth, and the truth will set you free from any sin and any deception. Hallelujah. Blessed Heavenly Father, we come in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. And I know that there are many of us in this room that, Lord, have went through some very troublous times in our life, within ourselves or with our family or in finances or on jobs. We've all gone through those things. But, Lord, it's so good to know you and to know there's a fountain of living water in life that we can come to and drink every day from, so that we don't have to continue going through all that turmoil. But we can come to you and drink. We can eat the meat of the Word and drink the milk and the living water of the Word of God. We can eat the bread of life. And Father, it changes us day by day. And all of a sudden, the things that used to really bother us don't bother us anymore. The way we used to look at ourselves and think of ourselves, we don't think that way anymore. The pride has been broken. The false humility has been broken. And now we just celebrate that we're a child of God, approved and accepted of you, a people who can love you and know your love, a people that can trust you to reveal the deception that the enemy brings, a people that, Lord God, do not have to be stirred to get us to move, but we move because your word is alive inside of us. We don't have to be stirred in the physical. We need to be stirred by a truth and become established in it and live in it from this day forward. So important, folks, so important. It's so important to us, Heavenly Father. We need to be quickened by your Holy Spirit. You'll move when you desire to move, and you're already moving, Father. We pray and people are getting healed. When this congregation prays, things happen. And I thank you for that, Father, that we're a praying church. And I thank you we're watching your hand. When the doctor says there's no hope, all of a sudden, the person's okay. We're watching you move, and we're thanking you for it. And we thank you that, Father, we are the elect. Not because we belong to this church, but because we belong to you. And you're teaching us. You're challenging us. And Father, I thank you that every one of us are passing the test. And our lives are becoming more and more in order with you. And more established in you and stable. So we thank you, we praise you. Bless each one as they go, Lord God, and let this word reside in their hearts. Let this word, Father, change, transform, and renew as they are energized to run harder after you. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name as we receive it done. And all the saints said, amen. Hallelujah. We'll give the Lord a praise. God bless you. Go in the peace, the grace, the mercy of God. Our God reigns. And happy Valentine's Day to all of you. Amen. God bless.
Take me back to the place that feels like home. To the people I can depend on. To the faith that's in my bones. Take me back to a preacher and a verse where they've seen me at my worst. To the love I had at first. Oh, I wanna go to church.